its setting, the name of the Lord is to be praised. The Lord is high above all nations, his glory above the heavens. Who is like the Lord our God, who is enthroned on high, who humbles himself to behold the things that are in heaven and in the earth? That's the question for us. Who humbles himself to behold the things that are in heaven and in the earth? He raises the poor from the dust. This is God. And he lifts the needy from the ash heap to make him sit with the princes of his people. Think about it. That's how much he cares for us. When we are in a right relationship with the Lord and when we really consider all of the things that are going on in heaven and in the earth and how God orchestrates it all, when we admit that we are poor and we desperately need a Savior, he raises us from the ash heap of sin and death and all of that type of stuff to make us sit with the princes of his people. He gives us position and a place of honor among the children of God. Verse 9, he makes the barren woman abide in the house, a joyful mother of children. Praise the Lord. And we're going to be talking about a little bit about children today in the morning service as well, so kind of keep that in the back of your mind. But let's do as the psalmist says for us to do. Let us sing our first song together and truly praise the Lord in worship.
Just lollipops, Tootsie Lollipops. They're the best. And, but you got to earn it. But these you don't have to earn. These are bookmarks. And the fancy bookmarks. But they got verses on them, like seven verses, called the Romans Road. Have you ever heard of it? No. Anybody? Romans Road? One, two, well, you're good. Okay. So, I got bookmarks for all the kids. And for those of you adults who commit to memorizing these six, seven verses, you get a bookmark. They're nice to use. You know what a bookmark is. Okay. Like, I mean, everything's electronic now, you know. So, you can pick one of these. In my Bible, I wanted to explain a few things. I'm going to talk a lot about the Bible, because that's why we're here. I have a study Bible. So, how many people have a study Bible? A few. We need more. So, if you want to understand the Bible, and sometimes it's really hard, you need help. This has helps built in. One of the things is a dictionary, right? So you go to a dictionary and you look up a word and find out what that word means. Or you ask your mom and dad. But you can look in a dictionary. Well, there's a Bible dictionary that tells you what the words mean. So you come across a word like righteousness. What does righteousness mean?
Right living?
But you can go to the dictionary and look it up, and it'll tell you. But the best thing is, I think, it's, I have been here, what do you say? All the ages. You need a, hopefully, they're going to get you each a study Bible. That's my thing, because you need one. That's important information to know. Right. So, the Bible talks about building precept on precept. And that's just Bible talk for learning one thing on top of another. Like, when you go from third grade to second grade, right, you use what you learned in second grade to learn third grade. Because if you didn't have second grade and you just skipped second grade, you went straight to third grade, so we want to start at the beginning, right, in the Bible, which is Genesis. Well, I was going to ask that question. We're running out of time already. Okay, so number one thing is to understand where sin came from. Anybody? From hell. That's a great answer. I agree with that. Adam and Eve?
From the devil.
That's a good answer. The devil, yeah.
The snake.
The snake, which was the devil,
yeah.
Right? Any other ideas? Okay, well, those are all good answers. So, we're going to read, just a few verses in Genesis chapter 3 in regards. The beginning of the chapter, it says the title is about the word above. Called the fall of man. So far God created all, he created, and it was all perfect, including Adam and Eve. Well, until. And then everything after that was different. So, now the serpent was more crafty than any beast of the field, which was the snake. Well, most people. Which the Lord God had made, and he said to the woman, "Indeed, God has said, you shall not eat from any tree of the garden." And the woman said to the serpent, "From the fruit of the trees of the garden we may eat, but from the fruit of the tree which is in the middle of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat from it or touch it, lest you die." So the first thing Satan, the snake, said to Eve was wrong. God says, you can't eat from any of the trees. No, she corrected him. She said, no. You can eat the fruit of the tree, just not certain trees. And the first thing Satan said was wrong. It was a lie. The first thing. But she knew better. So you shall not eat from it or touch it, lest you die. And the serpent said to the woman, "You shall surely not die." So again, he's lying. And for God knows that in the day you eat of it, your eyes will be opened. And you'll be like God, knowing good and evil.
How does one know that?
Well, didn't she kind of already know evil? I don't know. Maybe, I don't know. But he certainly makes an enticing. You'll be like God. Because they talk to God every day. They walk with God every day. They took a walk with God in the garden every day. The woman saw that the tree was good for food, that it was the delight to the eyes, and the tree was desirable. Make one wise. Well, the Bible says the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Now she already knew that God said, don't eat this think your head's going to get chopped off. I mean, you know, that's what you do when you're a kid. But that's what I still have it, so it didn't happen. But in verse 8, they heard the word, they heard the sound of God calling them after they sinned. Now talk about fear. If that doesn't make you afraid, after you know you sinned, so they hid themselves from the presence of God, and God called them and said, hey, where are you guys? Because they hid. They're hiding. They're like, we're out of here, man. But there's no place to go, obviously. God's everywhere. And he said, I heard the sound of you in the garden, he says, and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid myself. I was doing it for them. I said, well, who told you that? I got nothing. Whatever you say here. So what's he doing? He blames Eve. He says, well, the woman you gave me, she gave it to me. And Eve's like, well, wait, what? Well, it's true, but come on, you're just selling me under the bus here. So what's the woman say? He says, well, so what do you say? He says, well, it's the snake. She says, the snake did it. He gave it to me. So she's throwing the snake under the tree, under the bus. Nobody's taking accountability here anyway. Nobody said, yep, I did it. And so then the snake gets in trouble and God says, you're on the ground forever and all that stuff. So anyway, I want to begin with the first verse. You see it? How many of us can get the first verse? That you probably already have it, but yes. I'm so proud of her. I mean, she's amazing, right? We're going to go verse by verse each week, and then we're going to all say them together. It's only 6 or 7. You could probably do it in one. But I'm a little slower on the uptake. Remember where sin came from. It came from the devil, came from hell, and he enticed Adam and Eve, and it was all done. But the important thing is, Adam and Eve had children, right? That's why we're here. But Adam and Eve were perfect, but their children were not. Their children were born in a sin nature. So now we're all born. Everybody after that was born with a sin nature, which means it's natural for us to sin. And that's why Christ came to save us from our sin. So we've got to understand where sin came from. And then we're going to talk about all that means. So thank you for your time. And I'll try to be better faster next time. It's hard to go that fast.
Oh, I hear you. I preach a long message. All right.
I hear that. Yeah. Okay. Thanks, guys. And I'm going to do some games and stuff, too, but boy, they got to be fast games.
All right, Usherettes, I need your help. Frog Club, you go back to your seats.
So, what do I got? Eight minutes? 9 minutes?
Well, Lord works in mysterious ways. As long as we get through a service in a timely manner, we're good to go.
I'll try to time it next time.
All right. Help me out with the offering plates, ladies, and I'll say a quick word of prayer. We're going to take our regular tithes and offerings. This one goes to the ministries of the church and to keeping the lights on and to buying materials and all that type of stuff, paying the pastor, that type of thing, okay? But it's a very important time for us to really consider whether or not we're taking part in advancing the kingdom of God, okay? And this is just a simple way of saying, thank you, Lord, for what you're doing in my life, and I want to be part of your kingdom, and if you want to choose to build it in this place, by all means, Lord, I take this gift and and let's see it done, okay? So let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for what you're doing even in our midst. Lord, we thank you for the special ways in which you speak to us, and we lay things on our hearts. Lord, we thank you for our jobs and for the ability to have an income for our families and be able to take care of them. Lord, we know that those blessings come from you. Lord, this is a gift back to you from the bottom of our heart. We just want to see your kingdom succeed, even in this place. Lord, we just pray that you would use this gift for your honor and for your glory. And we pray that you would bless the true giver, the person who gives from their heart. We pray that you would multiply this gift for your use. Pray for all these things in Christ's name. Amen. Jeremy?